Akin Sawyerr. I lead up governance and strategy for Decred, which is a digital autonomous organization. And it's really built on this foundation that digital currencies are really the basis of new markets and new forms are taking place. So beyond thinking about currencies and how currencies enable markets, at Decred, we have a very sophisticated governance process and system whereby the users and stakeholders actually inform the governance process, right? You have an ability to stake value and vote and actually determine the future pathway of the network. And in many ways, Decred is the antithesis of Libra, right? When you think about Libra, it's sort of like, you know, in my view, like shifting the deck chairs on the Titanic, right? This idea that we have monetary systems that are run by governments, but now Libra is proposing monetary systems run by corporations. And I think that's actually a really bad idea. I think it's a bad idea because corporations over and over again have proven that in any situation where there's a principal agent, you know, problem, the agent will always do what's in their best interest, right? So Facebook does what's in its best interest with our private data to maximize its profits, right? The banks that almost blew up the financial system oftentimes, in fact, did things that were beneficial to the banks and detrimental to their customers, right? So I think the fundamental idea around centralized authorities having power to determine money and to determine monetary policy is flawed. And what truly decentralized cryptocurrencies give you is a system where the network now becomes the way to enforce monetary policy, right? So a Decred similar to Bitcoin, there'll only be 21 million Decred ever mined, right? So effectively it becomes a deflationary currency, right? And if we design the system correctly, is this idea that as the network and marketplace grows, value will accrue to the currency. So anyone that holds the currency benefits in the upside, right, of the value as that economy grows. Mm-hmm. In centralized systems, the beneficiary is the corporation, right? The corporations will get together to figure out how to capture the majority of the benefit, capture most rents to the detriment of the users. So, you know, we have a very, very different view, and we think that, you know, true decentralized currencies actually are the way to go in that they empower individual sovereignty. They're permissionless, so anyone can participate and adhere to the rules. They're censorship resistant, which is really important. It's this idea that my value and my wealth is controlled by me, and no third party can either tell me or, you know, censor me or exclude me from the financial system. And so I think those things are really important. And I think, you know, competition is good, and I don't want people to think that I don't think Libra should exist, but I think over time.
Well, Facebook, of course. That's
right. Sure, but I think over time it will be proven that fundamentally you cannot escape this idea that centralized systems are prone to capture. Right? There's a reason why, you know, even in the U.S. as a country, we elect public officials, but then over time they now start serving their interests and the interests of the few. Right? It's prone to capture. The banking system is prone to capture, right? That's an economic fact, and we've seen that happen over and over again, right? And I think that Libra will be no different because fundamentally you have a big dichotomy between the goals and the values of the Libra Council and what they want long-term and what's good for the individual. And at some point, there will be a clash of those two incentives. And more likely than not, the council will do what's in its best interest, right? We haven't even talked about things like the underlying data, right? We haven't talked about how Libra will extend surveillance capitalism, for example, where you now have KYC systems where people in emerging markets can now be tracked by the transactions, and that data becomes extremely valuable. Now, will the Libra Council make that freely open to everyone, or will they co-opt that data and information like they've proven over time too, and monetize that, right? Those are fundamental questions. And I think the other side of it too is, I think the goal of the Libra Council around financial inclusion, around remittances, I don't actually think that's feasible. I don't think it's feasible because if Libra is successful, for example, in a country like Zimbabwe or Nigeria and Africa that have fairly high inflation, as a utility, a lot of people would adopt it if it's more stable and a more stable store of value. But that fundamentally erodes the ability for central banks in those countries to control monetary policy. So no self-respecting central bank in an emerging world would allow Libra to basically co-opt its monetary policy, right? And I don't think there's any way that those goals will be reached without some sort of KYC, you know, extending the reach of US dominance and power. So I think fundamentally those goals are not actually attainable by the Libra Council. Right? Okay. So Decred has a decentralized governance system where every participant can opt into the governance framework. So I, as a holder of a token, can stake my token, and that gives me, one, a right to secure the network, but also gives me the ability to actually have a say in the governance process.
And how do you deal with scaling, right? Can you scale that, and how do you scale that?
So, I mean, you know, at Decred, we've had an off-chain governance system that's been live for over a year. We have hundreds, if not thousands, of users on the network who actually put proposals through the system, determine the future development of the platform, have individual sovereignty, right? There's no one who is going to have a greater deal of, you know, I think in human behavior, right, you are the best person to secure your self-interest. And when you delegate that power to someone else, you open up yourself to lots of risks and more
hazard.
Here's
the thing, though, because protocols like Decred are super important, those base layer protocols that are all going to be interoperable kind of components or puzzle pieces that various applications plug together to serve those end users.
To say that the bubble bursts simply because governments push back would also negate the effect of greed and all of the other bad aspects of human conduct that would be true
right,
in any
economy. Yeah, but I mean, there was an internet bubble and it bursts, but from that emerged Amazon and trillion-dollar companies, right? So I don't think that, I think in every new system, there's always going to be nefarious actors, but that's not the narrative, right? I think fundamentally what I'm talking about is that the rules of the game have to be fair and transparent, and the governance framework has to ensure that special interests do not take over these networks. And I believe that the only way to really get there is to empower the individual to have some level of, you know, base level sovereignty. Now, I think that once you have an economic system where the rules are clear, the rules can be gamed, and they cannot be changed by, you know, third parties who want to co-opt it, then other things get built on top of that, right? And so to the point you made about, you know, second layer implementations, we have second layer implementations already being built in Decred with Lightning Network. And we think that once we build all those pieces that ensure that the base layer rules are well governed and they're clear and they're trustworthy, then new layers will come and build on top of it. But it has to be in a permissionless and decentralized way where people are free to leverage the open source software, build iterations of it. They can build centralized systems and applications on top of it if they want. But the core rules, you know, have to be designed such that they're not co-opted. And my fundamental position is that anytime you have centralized authorities with the keys and with the ability to determine winners and losers, ultimately they'll make themselves the winners. And I think time and time in history we've seen that occur over and over again. And I'm not convinced that a council of self-interested companies can do money better than a decentralized system. I think fundamentally the regulatory system is designed for a past world, right? The regulatory system is designed where you have firms as intermediaries, right? People organize in firms because of all sorts of efficiencies, right? The reasons why firms exist is to cater to market inefficiencies, right? You know, the reason why people might work for a company is that it costs too much money looking for the next project over and over again. So maybe having a job and some stability makes sense. But the regulatory system was designed to police all these third parties, right, to, as much as possible, try to ensure that they do not act in a natural way to co-opt the system. To some extent, the regulatory system has been successful. And to a large extent, as we've shifted to a more technology-driven world, they have failed to keep up because they can't. Now, the future is in decentralized protocols where, you know, the regulators can actually see that the game is fair, right? The monetary policy of a cryptocurrency can be gamed, it can be audited, the game is fair.